have been involved with marketing for a million years and found that social has really changed everything. So I'm depending on these guys to tell us how. So if you guys would introduce yourself and talk a little bit about the social media that you either use or recommend.
Hi there, everyone. My name is Michelle Koenig. I'm with Fleet Feet Sports in West Hartford. Obviously, we're all from West Hartford, right? Majority of us. And I am the director of all of our community outreach and training programs, and that includes social media. We primarily use Facebook. That's probably our biggest outlet there. We also are really big into Instagram and Twitter. So those are our three biggest ones. And I'll hand it over to Chad.
Thank you. My name is Chad Turner. I'm president and co-founder of Go Media. We're a marketing and communications company down on Park Street, right over the West Hartford line. We, just to give you a little background on us, we act as our clients' external marketing departments. So when I think of social media, yeah, we dabble in it ourselves, obviously, because that's how we connect with our potential clients. But we manage a lot of our clients' social media. So we're into wherever they need to be. And for us, if you're marketing to other businesses, we're focused more on LinkedIn and Twitter. If you're marketing to consumers and making consumer decisions, we're on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook.
Morning, everyone. Dave Calabi, Big Thunk Internet Marketing. And for our social media, we primarily are on Facebook and LinkedIn.
I would love for you guys to talk about what a good website does.
For our website, I would say the biggest thing is user-friendly. So, you know, you want to make sure you've got the right titles up at the top so people can easily click and find what they need to find. The calendar on our website is probably the biggest spot. But that's because of our training programs. We have a lot of fun runs and things like that going on, so we get a lot of visits there. But I would say probably user-friendly. Go on there, use it yourself with fresh eyes, and make sure that everything is easy to find, information is there. Contact us is very important, particularly for people who can't find the answer to their question on the website. They want to be able to know how exactly they can reach you easily.
That's kind of a tough question to answer so broadly as far as what is a website. A good website going to do? I mean, it really depends on the audience and who you're speaking to and the type of information. Like Michelle was saying, whatever they're hunting. If they're on your website, they're hunting for some sort of information. Unless you're e-commerce and they happen to be just browsing for products. Either way, they're hunters. Make their job easy. Make it easy for them to get to where they need to go. Two clicks or less would be great, ideally. But just make it easy to use. If you are a consumer based and you see a lot of mobile, make your website responsive so that it works on all devices. That's what, I don't know if you're familiar with the word responsive, but responsive is when your website detects the browser and the width of which your browser is on. So it could be tablet, mobile, and it responds to that size and automatically changes it to that size. So if you're building a website now, you should really look at making sure that it is responsive so that it does work on mobile devices and just make the information that they're searching for easy to find.
Yeah, let's talk about a website in the terms of marketing for a second. There's something in marketing that some of you may be familiar with. It's called a marketing funnel. And it basically signifies that you try to get as many people into the top of your marketing scheme as possible, the right people. You don't want to get false positives. And it's a funnel because although you're trying to make it wide and get most of those people all the way through to the bottom, it just narrows naturally. And the layers of that funnel at the top are awareness. People's got to become aware of you. Then consideration, they want to consider your product. Then conversion, meaning they're actually going to do something that you probably want them to do and they also want to do. Then from conversion, it's loyalty, and then advocacy, where someone actually will refer someone else to you. So customer loyalty after they convert. Now that conversion may be collecting a lead or maybe selling a product. So the thing you need to determine whether your website is a good website is figure out what is it going to do for you in that marketing funnel. For most folks, they use things like search to create awareness and to get people to their website. And it's their website that causes their potential customers, their prospects, to consider them and then to convert. Again, that conversion may be just to put in a lead. So when you think about your website as how good it is, you have to think about, does it do those things? It might be pretty, it might be easy to use, but if it doesn't actually cause someone to consider your services or product and convert by taking an action that's mutually beneficial, then it's not a good website.
We are here talking about social media. So on your website, make sure you have the buttons for Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, whatever kind of social media outlets you want them to go to, Yelp, LinkedIn, all of those things, because we find that our website is great for first-time visitors or when you're looking for information, but the majority of our interaction with customers happens on Facebook. So make it easy for them to get to that point.
Yeah, that's a good setup. I have heard from some small businesses, well, I have a Facebook page. Do I really need a website? I would love for you guys to address that.
Absolutely. So Facebook is great, like I said, for daily contact. That's how we interface with our customers. We were just talking earlier, a lot of Fleet Feet customers are rabid fans. So we have daily interaction with the majority of them. That's not going to be true for all of you guys. But first-time visitors at all are going to go to the website. That's where they're going to find all the basic information, all of our store information, what our services are. That's where we have all of our training programs laid out. So all of that kind of stuff is very, very important to have there so that they're not calling the store all the time and we're not giving the same speech over the phone. Well, we have a 5K training program. This way it's easy for them to find information like that. When we want to have that direct connection with our customers, when we're posting articles, anything like that, that's when they're going to go to our Facebook page. So it is still very important to have your website. If you are selling any kind of services, and if you do sell online, that's an important spot to have it there. You can't necessarily do that on Facebook. So it is a useful tool as well.
Yes, is the answer to that question. For a lot of you, I think half of the people here are business to business, so you're not going to see, except your friends and family and friends of people you work with, liking your page on Facebook. It's just we haven't seen a lot of that success. You're going to get some of that, but you're all small business owners. Your time is valuable. You have to do billing. You have to do collections. You have to do so many different things. You're not going to have enough time, most likely, to run a Facebook campaign that's going to see the results you need if you're a business to business. Now, if you're a business to consumer like Michelle, that's where people are playing. I always use the analogy of, don't call me at home to sell me a printer for my office. And that's what Facebook is. People are there to engage with friends and family and see pictures of people's kids. Twitter is a different beast, and so is LinkedIn. I go to LinkedIn, I expect to see professionals there. I expect to see business. I'm going there with my business in mind. So it's a little bit different. So if I have a Facebook page, do I need a website? Yes, you do, because first of all, Facebook's not going to tell the whole story. Your website's your presence, and there's this thing called search engine optimization that you guys have all probably heard about that's going to play a crucial role in your business. I'm sure we're going to talk about that.
Yeah, just to echo the point here, if nothing else, think of your website as a business card, right? When someone wants to find out something about you, I don't know about you guys, but going to all the networking meetings, I have a pile of business cards on my desk. So when I want to find out what's their phone number again, the quickest thing to do is just go to find their website. How do you get a hold of you? So even if it's just a one-page resume kind of website, it probably makes sense to have the website. And if you think about social media in terms of that marketing funnel we just talked about, as Michelle was talking earlier, it's a great way to connect with clients. So it's down at the lower levels of that. After someone becomes a customer, that's how you create loyalty, and that's how you create advocacy. You can deepen the relationships you have with existing customers through those constant interactions and the social media site in a way that you can't at your website. But it's not it's much easier to have that business card as your website.
Each of you are into different social media. Talk about the difference in how you use, for business, Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn.
I think it's important to think about demographics when you're thinking about all those different outlets. So Facebook, you're targeting more of the middle-aged crowd. A lot of young people, high school, college kids even, are not using that now. And I know I don't know if it's going to be necessarily relevant for you guys, but that's big for us. the majority of our customers are going to be those middle-aged women. So Facebook is great for us. That's why it's our biggest social media outlet. But Twitter and Instagram, that's where you're going to attract the younger crowd. So if you're selling any kind of services that are trying to attract that younger crowd, that's where you want to be. And that's how we use it as well. Instagram's for fun stuff. We oftentimes take pictures of the store, employees having fun, new products that we have out there. Twitter is for a short little snippet. So kind of like Instagram without the pictures, although you can take pictures on Twitter now. And also for sharing information. So there's a lot of retweets on Twitter, articles that are interesting to your business, and that kind of stuff. And then Facebook is, like I said before, where you could have that kind of person-to-person interaction. So they do have different demographics. They're reaching different people, and that's important to keep in mind.
I think when you think about social media, you have to think about content, because content is really the king, and who you're talking to and engagement, right? So veterinarian hospital for cats, I expect you to be the expert in that field, and you should be posting things that, hey, it's cold outside, make sure your pets are... I'm looking for you to be the expert. You're using Facebook, you're using Twitter, you're using and even Instagram, probably not as much LinkedIn. Caterer, same thing. Here's a great recipe. You know, you're throwing things out. You're becoming a resource for your potential audience. And you're playing in the areas that they're playing in. So for us, I mean, as a business, we do everything because we need to keep on top of everything. But really, I think it more is what we do for our clients. And it comes down to where these guys are playing. So for UConn Athletics, we use pretty much Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. But for some of our health club software company that we market, we use pretty much LinkedIn and we use Twitter. So it really depends on it. And the big thing is, don't just set it out there and just post. Engage. Talk to people. That's what's going to gain results, not just posting. Engage and having conversations. And it takes time, and that's the biggest challenge for a small business owner, is that you might not necessarily have the time. So utilize your resources and put things in the right pecking order.
That's a great comment. I constantly meet with business people that think that everything is completely different online. And the notions that make you successful as an individual or as a business still apply in the online world. So if you're going to a networking event and you showed up, but you stood against the wall and didn't talk to anybody all night, is that a successful appearance? Have you made an impression? Have you got business? Well, it's the same thing online. The key is participation. You can create a LinkedIn page. You can actually post an article. But if you really want to succeed in most of these social media sites, you need to participate. So that means, like, for instance, in LinkedIn, you want to join a relevant group, and the mistake there would be to join a group of like-minded, you know, people. So you're preaching to the choir. If you're in marketing and you join a marketing group, you're not going to get business from those folks. You could talk about things and you could learn things, so you might want to join it for that reason. You want to join a group where your target audience is, and then you want to participate. You want to comment on other people's posts. You want to add your insights when other people make comments. So it takes, as Chad was saying, it takes time. There are resources, and you have to apply your priorities. But I want to dispel the notion that if I just create a great page and I post something and walk away, you know, once a month, I'm doing a good job out there, because you're not going to have the same success as if you actually participate, like the same as at that networking event.
It's not only important for you to participate as the business owner, but to ask for participation from your followers. That's a really, really big thing. A lot of the things that we post, we notice a big jump in views and in people actually coming into the store when we ask for their participation. So on Facebook, you know, you post a picture. Just yesterday I posted something, if you couldn't fail, if you could, I forget what the actual quote was, but if you couldn't fail, what would you do? If there was no chance of you failing. And then I asked on Facebook, we want to know, what do you think? What would you do? And then we got a whole bunch of responses to that. Oftentimes on Instagram, we'll have contests. So post a photo of you doing this, and then we'll pick the three best photos and come into the store and get a little freebie. So again, this is retail, so it might be a little bit different for some of you guys, but it's when you ask, everybody likes to talk about themselves. So it's when you're asking for that feedback, when you're asking for participation from your customers.
I just want to say that I would fly if I couldn't fail.
And it's the same thing at the end of a blog post. If you're an interesting blog, the best way to get interaction at the end is to ask a provocative question. So.
We have business-to-business clients, and so our goal with social is always to establish them as thought leaders. And the question before you post, you know, that think before you get behind the wheel, is would I, if I saw this, would I pass this on to someone? If your social media posts are all about you, woohoo, we got a new truck. Well, that changes everything. Make sure it's something that if you saw it, you'd choose to pass on, because that positions you as the thought leader. And I can't stress the engagement enough. It's called social. One of the primary reasons that people get involved in social is to improve their search engine optimization. So talk a little bit about search engine optimization, how you do that on the website, and how social feeds into that.
That's not my forte, so I'm going to pass it along.
Want to start?
Sure, if you want. So some of you have heard me have this discussion a little bit before, so I apologize if I'm repeating myself. But you know what is Google selling at their search engine? What they're selling is relevancy. When you type in a word or a phrase, the results that come up have to be relevant. If they're not, if they're consistently not, you're not going to use them anymore. You're going to go to Bing, someone that has more relevant search results. So when Google or the other search engines, and from now on I'm just going to say Google, looks at your website, it's trying to figure out what your website does so that when's the relevant time to surface it when someone puts in a search query. And while Google doesn't reveal its secret formula, its recipe for doing that, it does post its ingredients. It has posted online a PDF that goes through, here's all the 200 different things we look at. And a lot of these are kind of within your control. And some of them are things that are on your website, and some of the things that you can do to assist your website externally. So some of the things on your website, for instance, is have descriptive headings. So if it says about us, that doesn't help Google understand who you are. But if instead of about us, and it says expert car repair, well, geez, that kind of explains it, right? So you want to have a lot of headings. It also makes your site more readable, more user-friendly, but it also helps Google. Things like repeating you want to have informative navigation the same way. Instead of just saying services, you might say auto repair services, like, and repeat those things in the footer. So there's a whole list of things you can do on your site. And then externally, you want to try to have links back to your site. If you have a cross-linking program with your vendors, for instance, you link to their site, they link to you, because Google says, geez, if all these other sites find this site important to link to, then it must be important. So there's a number of things like that, and social media is one of those things that could link back.
That's all good stuff. So we as a firm, we got behind SEO about 5 years ago, and we spent a lot of time doing that for ourselves because we felt like this would be a good use of our time for ourselves. So like Dave was saying, we tried to figure out keywords. So if you're looking for an ad agency, chances are you're going to go into Google and you're going to Google ad agency. Well, we're not going to be able to compete as well on a national level. So we added CT to that. And now if you Google ad agencies CT, we're number one. And the size of our firm, being 10, doesn't compete necessarily with the size of the other firms on that number one page list. But because our SEO is there, we get a lot of inbound traffic and inbound inquiries. We're not always the best fit for everybody. But the fact is that we localized it, and that raised our... So if you're a caterer in Connecticut, you don't really need to be worrying about catering in Wisconsin. So if you're just catering CT or catering Hartford CT, try to specialize it and narrow it down, because people actually do search with that in mind. So B2B, I would say this is probably right there on the top of your list of things that you should be concerned with. Now, before you go out and do all your SEO, you need to make sure your website says what you need it to and make sure it communicates it properly. We always use this as an analogy. If you're going to send out invitations to the party, make sure you plan the party first so that when they arrive, they don't walk in the room and be like, is this the right place? Did I get to the right place?
And the website is the party.
And the website's your party. Because you're going to walk in the door. If they don't know, if they don't think that they've got to the right place, they're going to bounce out of there. And Google calls that a bounce rate. So they're going to look at that and they're going to say, oh, over 50% of the people that arrived at your website, they left within minutes or seconds. They didn't really click around. You guys, your bounce rate's too high. We're going to hurt your search engine rankings. Another thing Google is changing that you should be aware of in the near future is that if your website is not optimized for mobile, it's going to hurt your rankings as well. So something to think about as you're looking, build that website, build it nice, make sure it communicates the right message, and then build in those search terms using title tags, metadata. And there's tons, like Dave said, there's tons of resources to be able to do that. But a lot of these pre-built templates, website, Wix, web.com, all these places, they have it all set up. They understand like where you should be filling in the right keywords and whatnot to get you guys rankings up. But B2B can't be more of a priority for you.
Those templates can help, but it's still up to you to figure out what those keywords are and to put them in there. So you can put bad headings or bad keywords in or good ones. So
that brings us to the ever frightening world of analytics. And I know it's before breakfast for many of you, so we won't get too heavy. But like it or not, I think all of us have to understand what those things that Google presents us with are. So if you guys could do it without putting everybody to sleep, I would appreciate it.
I'll let these guys talk about Google, but I'll talk about Facebook analytics after that.
That's good. Well, I mean, we've become immersed in big data. I mean, 10 years ago, you had no idea if your marketing was working. They'd have a 50% rule. 50% of it works, 50% of it doesn't work. You just don't know which 50%. Well, now big data has changed everything. All of our clients want to know. They want to see the ROI, which is great. We do too. I mean, we want to get the results. So analytics is huge, right? So how much traffic am I driving? We set up the weekly reports. We use the analytics as gut checkers. You can do campaigns through them. There's a lot of layers that you can get yourself into with the analytics. Overall, you want to know if something's working. So on the grand 30,000 foot scheme, weekly impressions, unique views. I don't know how many of you guys are tabbed into the analytics, but it is important that if you're going to invest in your website to kind of know what if things are working. And driving traffic to your website is a good early indicator of whether or not you're going to increase business.
So before I answer that, I just want to do two more quick things on search. There are directory services out there. Google hasn't, Bing hasn't. Make sure that your company is listed in the directory services, the big ones, and listed consistently across them so that you don't confuse them, listed the same way with the same information. And also customer reviews are really big at Google, and the other search engines weigh those. So in terms of analytics, Chad is right. First of all, Google Analytics is free. It's amazing what you get with Google Analytics. You can live all day and you can find out almost anything you want. How many people go from this page to this page? All kinds of detail. So you have to figure out what you want. And to do that, you have to just kind of remember that marketing is about experimentation. So what you're, create a marketing program and you want to know if it's working. And if it's not, based on the analytics, you want to change it. If it is, you want to do more of it. So that means you're going to be experimenting, you're going to be changing things up, and then you want to try to figure out what things in the analytics are going to tell you if that marketing program succeeded. So you want to think about that as you're putting in place that marketing program. What am I going to examine and know if it actually worked or not? And key to that, going beyond just the visits, is your conversion rate. So if what you're trying to do is get people to give you a lead through your contact us page, one good thing to do is know how many people come to your site, but then of those, how many actually hit the contact us page, and then that percent is your conversion rate, and you want to try to optimize that conversion rate and try different things to do that.
So Facebook makes it very easy for you to keep track of how many likes you're getting, what kinds of posts are being liked the most, what times of day your people are liking posts. So these are all very useful tools. If you go through and you notice, all right, well, that post really failed and nobody liked it, what was it about? What was its theme? And kind of try to figure out why it didn't work. We found that the majority of our posts that people like are ones that either ask for them to participate, so those that are asking for their feedback, personal pictures, so not just a photo that we found online, but if we have an event in the store and we post a whole bunch of pictures about it, people love those posts. And then lastly, articles of interest. So we do a lot of that on Twitter. We retweet a lot of articles of interest, but on Facebook we post that probably once or twice a week. just different training tips, different marathons that people might want to get involved in. And those kinds of information posts are really, really big. So that's what works for us. And we found that just by looking at that analytics page on Facebook. You could also, like I said, find out what times of day your people are going to their Facebook page. So for us, we do get some on the weekends, but the majority of people, they're at work. So you're going to get them in that 9 to 5 kind of bracket is when you get the largest audience. So we do a lot of stuff in that time frame as well. We generally have a post around 11 a.m. and then another one around 3 p.m. So that's another good thing to look at. It's going to be different for everybody. Everybody's business is different. But if you could know that, then you're really optimizing your use of Facebook. You're reaching the most amount of people as you can. Another way, and this doesn't necessarily go with this, but there was a question about it before, using boosts to promote certain posts. So if you have a really important one, for instance, we are hiring now. So just a few weeks ago, we wanted to put that out on our Facebook page. So we boosted that post. You could put money behind certain posts. And it's really easy with your credit card. You just do it right there on Facebook. And from that, the views of that post exponentially greater than what we normally get. Just because we put that, and you could put as much money behind it as you want, and Facebook will just keep putting it out there and putting it out there. So that's a great way to reach a larger audience, draw more people to your Facebook page, get more likes in the end, get more customers in the end. So I wouldn't recommend doing that all the time. You don't want to saturate everybody's feed with a lot of different posts, but every once in a while when you have something really important to get out there, that's a good thing to do as well.
What happens when you choose to boost? Can you explain a little bit about that?
So Facebook sometimes, particularly if you post just a photo, they're not going to necessarily put that on a lot of feeds. I don't know how Facebook works way up in the ether up here, but words get posted more. Words and photos get posted the most. So if you have a photo and you attach text to that, that's going to get posted the most. A lot of stuff, for instance, when we post just a picture of a vendor's shoe or something that maybe says ASICS or a logo, something like that, Facebook does not like to promote that stuff. They don't like to necessarily have it be ads on everybody's Facebook feeds, and that's kind of how that stuff reads. So the more you can make it personal, the better. But when you boost a post, because you're putting money behind it, Facebook is going to get it out there more for you. So the amount of money that you put behind a post is going to affect how much more they boost it for you and how much more they get it on other people's feeds.
Probably add to this a little bit. So we do a lot of advertising on Facebook. And one of the cool things about Facebook advertising is, well, first of all, how scary we can target you, number one, based on your likes, where you live. Everything. I mean, if you put something on Facebook, I can pretty much advertise to you based on that. But also, they have what's called a pay-per-click method, which means I'm only going to pay for the people who click on my ad, which is actually pretty cool. Because if you think back, if I was placing an ad in a newspaper or on a billboard and I put a phone number and said, I'm only going to pay you, and if I told one of our sales reps, I'm only going to pay you for everybody that calls, they look at you like you're crazy. But Facebook's platform, that's the same as Google SEM as well, search engine marketing, where you pay per click. So you're paying for results, which is pretty cool. But going back to the kind of things that Facebook a lot likes and doesn't like. So back when they went public a few years ago, they started shrinking the number of people that are going to see your post from a business page, and they did this because they needed to make more money, and they want you to pay for your posts. They want you to see it. Things that will see more organic traffic are photos without external links. They don't want you to leave Facebook. Go figure. So you post a photo. So last night, the UConn women's basketball team won the AAC championship. We post a photo. We say AAC champions. No link. Everybody shares it. It goes through the roof. Tons of likes. If we post the same thing with a story on UConnHuskies.com, because we want to ultimately drive traffic to our website, that post doesn't get nearly as many organic. It just sees it as, we don't want to point people that way, so we're not going to show it into as many feeds. So there's a game to it. Good photos, things that we say is, and I think Andrea touched on it, is this, you know, your authority in your market. But more importantly, if you saw this, would you share it? Would you share it with the people that you're following? And those are the posts that are going to do the best.
So now we're getting into some real marketing stuff. It's good stuff. So you know, Chad's right. You can put that ad, and you're only paying per click. And to some extent, that is fantastic. But remember, we talked about earlier that conversion rate. So, you know, this, you have to be careful how you structure that ad, because if the ad is misinterpreted, you might get a lot of false positives. A lot of people clicking that ad thinking they're going to one thing, but they're actually something else, and so they bounce away. You paid for that. So what you really want to know eventually is, do the calculation is, what did I pay per lead, and what, you know, with those ads, and then what was my conversion rate, and how many of those turned into business, and then, you know, was it worth it? And if not, how do I change that? A great example is, we had a client who did knife sharpening for people. And if you put knife sharpening up there, it turns out a lot of people are looking for how to do it themselves. So they click and they go, oh, I didn't want someone to sharpen my knife. I want to figure out how to sharpen my knife. So you have to be very careful with that ad. The other thing you have to be careful with is the boost. Michelle is correct. That's a great way to expand your reach. But at the same time, Google keeps track of your participation rate. And your participation rate determines how widely your posts are distributed organically. So she's got a great audience that participates a lot. And when she doesn't boost that post, she gets a high participation rate. But if you boost it, Google's going to send it to a lot of people that, you know, they're marginally associated with you, and your participation rate is going to drop. And if you do that too often, that could end up hurting you. That's why you don't want to, as she said, continually boost everything.
And then just to clarify too, the ads on Facebook are different than boosting, just so we make sure that we're all clear on that.
I think now is a good time to talk about a successful campaign, because I think we're getting a little bit into the weeds. If you could talk about a campaign that you guys did for a client, you did for Fleet Feet, that really worked, and talk about what you did and why, I think that'd be very helpful.
One of the most successful things that we had was last summer. We had a fun run, which is just a short little run that we have at the store. Oftentimes we involve a vendor in that. So this particular fun run involved Brooks. It was a superhero fun run. We created a specific hashtag for that event, and we asked people to go on Instagram and to take pictures throughout the whole event, hashtag it with that particular event, specific to that event, and then we would choose photos afterwards. It was a contest. You won a free pair of Brooks shoes. The numbers of Instagram followers that we got from that was astronomical. It was fantastic. So again, it's that asking for participation. It's asking your customers to participate in it. Now, Fleet Feet's a little bit different. We have that customer base that we have continuous, we have people coming back all the time. So we like to create that community. May or may not work for your business, but if you can somehow devise some way for your customers to participate in your social media, I think that's always a very, very effective method.
We get a lot into this, because we try to stretch our clients' marketing dollars a lot, and earned media, where you're getting buzz and word of mouth, and PR for it is a big part of our strategy. But so I'm going to eliminate UConn, because there's too many examples where it's too easy to integrate, because you have, just like Fleet Feet, you have a rabid fan base, and you put something out there and it just goes. But I'll use Wooden Tap as an example. It's a restaurant group. They've got 8 locations. We were coming up with a new menu design, and they were celebrating 10 years, and we were trying to think of something, a way to promote the new menu and the new menu design. So we ran a Instagram contest where if you took a photo of it's like a selfie or something at Wooden Tap, and you hashtagged it, we would potentially use that photo on the menu. So now we have about 10 or 15 different versions of these, and we have people taking photos of the menu with their photo in it. So it works out really well. We got a lot of Instagram followers. We got a lot of engagement, and it was a fun contest, and we actually like the way it looks too.
Yeah, that's very creative. That's cool. So I'm going to give you an example of something that we did that you can all do that was successful for us. And it actually, I think it was Chad that was, or maybe Michelle, maybe both, that said you should be commenting about stuff that you know about. So we wrote a blog post some time ago. I think it was the one about 5 things that your homepage should do for your business. And then as we always do, and I think you should always do, we try to make more of an integrated campaign and reuse that. So we posted it on Facebook, and we sent out something to our email marketing list that said, hey, we wrote this blog post. Here's the first paragraph. If you want to read more, send some back. And the reason you do that is because people take in their news different ways, right? Not everybody's checking the same things. But then we went to LinkedIn, and we're part of a lot of different groups in LinkedIn, and we kind of started discussions in LinkedIn. It says, is your homepage working for your business? Here's an article that might help you figure that out. No pressure. And a couple weeks later, we got a phone call from a guy who said someone else shared it on LinkedIn, and he read it and thought, he needs to do a better job with his, and it turned into business for us. So that to us is a successful integrated marketing campaign, but it's no magic there. It's nothing that you couldn't do based on your expertise.
You don't want anything else? You brought up the blog, and this has been my recent conversion because my website person beat me up about not blogging enough. And I found out that the blog has been the engine, and many of you are in personal services. The blog post has been the engine for everything. So I want to talk a little bit about how we did that, and I'd like you to address it. We do a lot of blog posts, but once a month we do a blog post that involves an original cartoon. In our case, we're trying to establish thought leadership about our crisis communications work. And so we do a cartoon every month. I do a blog post. I then use a constant contact e-blast campaign to my marketing list. And believe me, if you've met me, you're probably getting these, whether you like it or not, because that's how I use cards at networking. So add them to the list. Mike, you're getting them, right? Add them to the list at least once a month. You're getting a laugh. You're getting a little information. Post that and then support it with social in a variety of ways. So, again, you're personally going out to that A-Blast list. You're then going out publicly through Twitter, LinkedIn, and Facebook. And I'm talking about the corporate page, our corporate page. So you take and you reuse it. And it's all about establishing, for us, news you can use. So again, things that you can pass along. Michelle, I want to build on what you and also Dave talked about, which is creating brand advocates. And that's a buzz term in marketing. But the idea is using those people who are connected with you socially to talk about how wonderful you are and to pass along what you say and get people talking about you.
First, just to touch upon the blog, talking about that, we do not currently have a blog. We are talking about maybe having one in the future, but what we do have is a bi-weekly newsletter where Steph, the owner of our store, writes her own personal little thing in there. It's also a newsletter. There's other things involved, but she has her intro. And people love that newsletter. We send it out through Constant Contact. Like I said, it's bi-weekly. We also have a link on our Facebook page, and it's on our website. It creates a personal face to the business. Fleet Feet's not just a store. It's different from other retail stores, and like I said, we create that community. Our customers are constantly coming back. Yes, they need to come back for new shoes. Yes, they need to come in for, you know, apparel and hydration and all that kind of stuff. A lot of them come in for our training programs, and a lot of them come in just for our fun runs. They like the idea of being involved in this running community. And by having Steph send out that newsletter every couple of weeks, it creates a face for the business. So they know all of us. They know all the employees, people who run the training programs. And then they know Steph. And that's huge. She's the owner of the store. And people love that they have that personal connection to her. So if we do decide to go the blog route, it'll probably be something like that. It won't just be Steph, but it'll be different staff members commenting on different things. But for right now, we've got that newsletter, and it is invaluable.
What's the difference between posting that newsletter versus a blog?
It's just how it comes out. To me, my blog posts are my version of a newsletter. So you can use a newsletter. Blogs, just it's posted online. That's all. A blog is short for weblog. So there isn't a difference. And for many of my clients, right, but it's how you post it and the way that you do it that you maximize it. And remember the goal, to drag them to the store, to drag them to the website.
And now to talk about a little bit about using your customers as your best advocates. That's something luckily, and I know it does have to do with our customer service, but we don't necessarily have to work a lot on that. One of the best tools you have as a small business is word of mouth, right? That's going to be kind of your best advertisers. Yelp is huge for us. The comments that we get on Yelp, if we ever get a slightly negative comment, Steph is quick to respond right away. So you see that the business owner is not ignoring that comment. That's very important. So you want to respond to the positive and the negative comments. Yelp is great for that. So a lot of people, a lot of customers will go there to kind of look at it before they come into the store. You could check in on Yelp when you're at the store and kind of post right there. So that's a very useful tool. On Facebook, we're constantly getting people responding to our posts and even just commenting on our page and saying, thank you guys changed my life. I mean, the positive responses we get, we almost, and I don't want to say this, we almost have too many of them. And like I said, it's not necessarily something we have to work too hard at, but we definitely repost all of that. We make sure our customers know, and it's just, they're talking to each other, which is the most important part, just that word of mouth going on. So it all comes down to customer service. You know, you treat your customers right and they're going to be return customers and they're going to tell their friends about it. I just recently stayed, I was in Vegas a couple of weeks ago for vacation. I stayed at the Wynn. The customer service that I received as a guest there was incomparable to anything I've received anywhere before. And because of that, I've told everybody, I'm telling a room full of people right now that next time you go to Vegas, you got to stay at the Wynn. So create that face to your business, create that good customer service, and people will start talking.
You just laid this up for me so perfectly. Thank you. First of all, the reason why they're getting such good brand advocates is because they're a good brand and they treat people well. And what she just did there with the win is exactly what I wanted to talk about, which is social currency. So that's a buzzword too. I don't know if you guys are familiar with it, but so the idea behind social currency is that she's telling people all about her experience because she's actually doing it selfishly, because when you go to the win and you have a good experience, you're going to say, man, that girl, Michelle from Flea Feet, man, she really had it right. And then she can feel good about herself. So you're selfish. No, but the truth is that we all are this way. If you go and have a good experience at a restaurant, if you have any sort of good experience, you want to spend that currency and provide something good to somebody else so that you could be that person that shares that. So that's why things go viral. Because have you seen this video of this squid eating a turtle or whatever it was? I don't know. But it doesn't matter. Like, or this baby falling asleep. I mean, you want to be the one to share it with your friends because it gives you credibility. It's very selfish if you think about it. But at the same time, you're providing a resource for your friends and a resource for people. So how do you create brand advocates? Be a good brand. Treat people well, and they will treat you well. I mean, that's really, it sounds simple. But if you think about it, how many experiences have you come across in your personal life or business life where you actually want to tell other people about it? It's not that often. So when you do get it, like the win, you can't wait to tell other people. So treat people well, and everything else will come back to you.
And just echoing what Chad said, the whole social currency thing is the key to all of it. It's a bit tougher when we're B2B or when we have services that you only use very rarely. But there, what you want to try to do is facilitate that social currency by making it easy for your customers to give that referral. And you got to not be afraid to ask for them to give a referral. I mean, we're used to doing that in the real world. Again, it's no different online. So your email marketing campaign is a great way to stay top of mind with past customers. You might want to segment your distribution list, right? You have prospects, you have customers that are advocates already, then you have customers that probably don't want to hear from you quite as frequently, but you know that they're interested in this topic, and so maybe once a quarter or twice a year, you might want to send them an email, just remind you that you're there, here's the special we're running, if you know anybody, and they will be happy to refer you if they had a great experience with you.
I want you to go to and study Zappos, because Zappos is the most amazing example of building a relationship with somebody you'll never see. How many of you know? How many of you know what Zappos is? What they do is sell shoes online, and this is something that people are passionate about, because every customer touch point
every time someone interacts with Zappos, from their social to their website to if you ever call, even to the box, there is brand consistency in the voice in which they speak to you. And I would urge you to read a book called Open Happiness. And it's about how it's about the Zappos brand, because all of what we're talking about, from the building of a wonderful brand that already has passionate advocates. I mean, I've only been into Fleet Feet 3 times, and I talk about it all the time because of the way they treated me. That's the customer touch point. Tony Hsieh, who is the president of Zappos, says that you never know where that customer touch point is going to be. So you better make sure the people on the phone treat you the same way as the people in social, so that there's a voice that's consistent. Before we open it up to questions, I would love you to give what not to do's on social.
You know, Chad was talking about it as being a party, right? If you're at a party, you don't want to see a guy in a booth selling ShamWows. So you just, you know, be considerate. It understand who your target audience is and structure your message appropriately, and understand the venue you're in and act accordingly. If you're not acting appropriately, that's the thing not to do. Don't act inappropriately for the audience in the venue.
I mean, there's been a lot of fails in a lot of the client industries that we've gone with. I mean, you guys have seen it in the news, or you've seen it on SportsCenter all the time. But the big thing is that from a B2B standpoint and in a B2C standpoint, don't be too pitchy. Don't try to sell. Be a resource. Provide shareable content. Would you share this? It's not always going to be a home run, but just don't be too pitchy and become more of a resource.
Ditto. Yeah, that's the biggest thing is, as a retail store particularly, you have to be very cognizant of that. People are already coming to the store. They already know that you sell stuff. So just establishing more of those relationships than shoving new products down their throat. And we do have probably once a week, once every couple weeks, we do a new product post on our Facebook page, but that's it. That's all that we do for that. The majority of what we do on Facebook is that person-to-person interaction, sharing articles, sharing information that maybe is associated with a brand or a particular vendor, but it's not shoving that salesy pitch down their throat.
So just again, to strike that point that it's not so different in the online world as it is in the real world, monthly the Chamber has business after hours events, and I encourage all of you to come to them. They're fantastic. And there tend to be, while we have some formal networking and we tell our stories in the morning events, it tends to be more social. People have, there's food, there's drink, and every now and then there's a guy that doesn't get it. And he's giving out his business cards and brochures, and he's not talking to anybody. He's just going from one person to the other, trying to sell. And everybody shakes their heads and goes, what's this about? And he's not successful, right? It's the same thing online, you know, being too pitchy online in a social environment. It's no different. If you wouldn't do it offline, don't do it online.
The idea of not making it all about you. And this is really hard for those of us who are small business owners, because everything we have in our business, we created and we want to crow about and we want to talk about. Trust me, I'm an only child. I know I'm the center of the universe. I got that already. But restrain yourself from having it all about you and making it all about your customers. We have some time for questions. I know you guys are here with great thoughts, and we've probably covered about 10% of them. So if you could, anything that you'd like us to talk about?
We were talking about putting a personal face to your business, and that's one of the best ways to do it. So outsourcing is good in that you don't have to do that daily, the day-to-day maintenance yourself. Particularly for Facebook, there's a lot of upkeep, managing comments particularly. You know, sometimes people are going to post things that are not so good, and you need to catch those things right away so that you can either respond to them in a few cases, if you catch them right away, delete them. So it does require daily maintenance. I do all of the Facebook monitoring for our store, and it is constantly up on my computer all day, every day.
I'm a crisis manager, and I have to tell you one thing. It is usually a bad idea to delete a negative post. And the reason is your reaction is, get it gone. But what happens if I delete a negative post? What'd you say? Well, it takes away your credibility, because what happens is then it gives the person who did the negative post license to say, oh, I hit a nerve, I'm going to go back. So 9 times out of 10, it's better to keep that post up there and respond. And if you've got somebody that is loving the spotlight, going, we had this with a client of ours. Believe it or not, we have a Facebook page for a retirement community that we work for. And guy posted a comment that I knew as a crisis manager was about to go negative. It's a very expensive retirement community, and it sounded like an innocuous question. Oh, how much does this cost? But I did a little research into who this guy was, and I knew where we were going. And I didn't want it to go. And my client was like, get it down. I said, nope, you're going to respond with love. So happy to hear you're interested. Let's talk offline about what you'd like. That bothered him, so he said, I don't want a sales pitch. And she said, well, now I have to talk about it. No, you don't. Glad you're interested. Here's my phone number. Here's my email. He went away.
And I just want to clarify. So a negative customer comment, you don't want to delete those. We recently had somebody post an event for something of their own on our Facebook page, and that I took down. They were advertising on our Facebook page. That wasn't cool. So it's things like that. But that's why you have to monitor every day, because you got to see what's going on there. So as the business owner, you should have some involvement. If you do outsource it, make sure you're checking in every once in a while.
This is a tough one for me, because we are, in some cases, the people that they outsource to, because we do manage a few social media accounts. If you're going to do it, but we also, in those situations, we don't just do their social media. We're heavily involved in all aspects of their marketing. So we are really a part of them. We wear their badge on our sleeves. So we can speak on behalf of them. We can, you know, we're thinking with them. They've given us enough rope to hang ourselves, so we don't have to clear everything through them. So we're really a part of, we're their marketing department, essentially. So we do that. It's not going to be the right fit for most of the people in this room, though, I would think, because it does involve a lot of resources. But I will say that if you're going to have a Facebook page up there, or even a Twitter, and if somebody's talking at you, you have to have the resources to be able to answer them. Because leaving it unopened, that would be like letting the phone ring and never calling them back. You know, they leave a message, you never call them back. And we have clients that, you know, when you have restaurants, there's sometimes bad experiences. Answer, we care very much about your experience here. We're glad that you came back. Let's, you know, what Andrea said is to the T, get that conversation offline as quickly as possible. But answer them publicly. And that's been pretty much protocol, and that's been said. So does it make sense to outsource? There's definitely, you can Google social media managers, and you'll find companies all over the country that do it. But there is that personal touch that you could be escaping unless they're in a situation where they're fully embedded into your business.
So I think what Chad said is key. If you consider using someone else to do it, and it's perfectly fine to do that, you should think of them as an extension of your company and let them know what you're thinking and what you're planning. You should have routine meetings at least once a month, put together a marketing calendar for the month. But they should know what's going on in your business because they're representing you. And if you don't have the time to do that, if you don't have the time to post yourself, but you don't have the time to bring someone in as if they're part of your company, then I would not do it. I would not outsource it, because you're probably wasting your dollars.
Isn't that the big challenge, to be consistent with posting?
It is.
It fits and starts. You post a lot at the beginning, and then it tapers off. Then you do your newsletter again, and it tapers off. Any tips on
it? It is definitely time intensive, but I absolutely agree with Dave that don't start it if you have the time. And one other thing I want to talk about in terms of alternative resources, all of us think the right way to do this is to hire a 20-year-old and put them in charge. Trust me, I teach 20-year-olds at Quinnipiac, and they do not know how to do social media for business. They know how to tell you that everyone, we need to meet, let's meet after school at Auntie's to get drunk. They know how to do that. Do not assume that someone 20 years old knows how to do this for business. Handing it off to the interns can be very, very dangerous. Any other questions?
I did want to respond to the consistency. One of the benefits about having a business Facebook page in particular, and I'm not talking about Instagram or Twitter here, but for Facebook in particular, you can schedule posts. And that's one of the most useful tools ever. So on Mondays, I go in and I schedule all the posts for that coming week. Now, if I need to tweak them throughout the week, I could go back in and do that. But I know that everything is there that needs to be said. I can make changes as I go along. But if I forget to do something, if I don't think about it, it's going to go out automatically. And that's an extremely useful tool.
A plan of just the one thing about, and if you are going to schedule it out, just be mindful if something major happens that you get to that Facebook page and turn it off. So like Whitney Houston dies and you're posting about something that's not Whitney Houston, the internet will react to that. And it's like very obvious when someone scheduled a post and something major happened. Because the internet, there tends to be like this big like, you know, is it white and gold or is it blue and black? And there's this big overtaking of, and the internet sort of moves like a big wave. And if you're not a part of that, it's very obvious. So you should be a part of that wave. Yes, if it's and it can be predictable and you can know it. But scheduling posts is great. I mean, because it keeps you on track and you know. Then we do it all the time. But as far as regularity goes, and this is where it comes down to resources. That's why I would say, you know, based on what you do and what you need to do, is that the best place for your resources? Focus on your own media, which is your website, and your materials, your video assets, whatever you're doing on the own side. Earned media would be your social. That would be the next thing in line before you get to paid. Exactly. You can't do everything.
So the question is, if you have a project you want to show off, like a design, is it me focused? What I would say, putting on my PR hat, is what were the lessons that you learned from that project that you could share for the rest of us? So instead of saying, woohoo, what kind of design? Give me an example of a project.
I get a logo assignment, and instead of just showing it off, I'm trying to explain, well, this is the process I used to arrive at the solution, and how did it help?
Well, yeah, so let's say he has a new logo. What you can do is see what the lessons are for the rest of us in how you overcame that challenge, and then post that as an example of how to come to a solution. Now you've got news you can use.
I would just add that that's like a case study in a way, and it's very similar to what you do. I wouldn't do that every single post, but a designer I think it was in Minnesota, he posted a redesign of every NFL helmet last week or 2 weeks ago, and it went viral. So you never know, you know? So yeah, just don't do it every time. But yeah, I think case studies are cool.
I just reiterate, it shouldn't be about you. It should be about how you're helping a client or how others could think about their logos. And so the more you make it as an educational piece, you know, when we first started doing this, someone said, Dave, you're giving away all your secrets. And the answer is, if someone's a do-it-yourselfer, they're not going to hire me anyway. What you're really trying to do is demonstrate your expertise and establish credibility.
So the question is, she moved Martha Stewart, and instead of talking about, woohoo, we moved Martha Stewart, a great headline would be, Martha Stewart's a really nice person. Why? Because it goes against the narrative, and people are going to want to share that.
We worked with Kara Sutherland, yeah, for the Hartford Marathon 5K last fall. She came into the store, Steph fit her for shoes, it was a whole news story. And so what we posted about it was so exciting to work with Kara, you know, more of a, we made a new friend kind of a thing.
I'll just give you the other side of that. It just being devil's advocate. If you want to work with more people like Martha Stewart, you might not want to tell people you worked with Martha Stewart. Unless she's cool with it.
Again, take it for something that the rest of us can relate to. It's not about you. It's like dating. It's not about you. It's about listening to the other person. Well, the question is about blending the two. I'm a small business owner. My name is in the name of the business. I have my personal Facebook page. That's where you'll find out my kids in Africa. I don't on the company page tell you that my kids in Africa. So it's more about separating the content. And again, what do you want those two things to do? But when it comes to something like Twitter, and my job is to establish myself as the brand voice of my company, I only have one Twitter account. And that's the one that I expect to show up on my bottom line.
Absolutely, yeah. I know it's difficult, and I am not a small business owner, but I see it very closely with staff. And when it is your business, it's sometimes really hard to separate the two. But I think just kind of approach it as you would approach any other job. You're not going to post about, you know, your dog is sick or your kid just got an A on a test. You're not going to necessarily post that on your business page. That's something for your private Facebook page. But I do know it's hard to separate the two when you're so closely linked. But I think on Facebook it's a little bit more important than it is on Twitter and Instagram. Like you said, you're your brand advocate for Twitter, and that's it's important to have that one account. Facebook, you can divide a little bit more.
Again, I think it's a lot about your audience, and there is going to be some blending, but not a lot. I think about a lot of my friends on Facebook are clients, so I'm mindful of what I post, but I would be mindful anyway because I know whatever I post is for everyone anyway. So I look at it that way, but from a business standpoint, our company, but we do post things sometimes when, we sponsor a basketball team in West Hartford, Go Media. We almost won the championship. We lost by 3 yesterday. Youth basketball, we would have posted that. Even though it's a personal thing, there's sort of a crossover there with the company. So there is some crossovers, but it's just natural that if you're a small business owner and you have a personal account, you basically are representing that brand too anyway.
Just to take a quick step back, in case someone doesn't know, you can create an actual business page in Facebook, and you should. So it's not like you're trying to use one page to do both things.
We have one more session on mobilizing print and online advertising on a budget.